So welcome to the lecture 8 of the design and analysis of algorithm course. In this session we are going to talk about matroids, and we are going to see that how it is related to the greedy methods, and we will be seeing that one problem that can be solved using this. Actually these are the very very special kind of structures that possesses the greedy choice property. So if you have some computational problem and you can map it to the matroids, then since there is a settled proof that if the solution that is being obtained by the matroid actually has the greedy choice property, so definitely it means that you can find out the efficient solution of the problem that they are given to you, and you can find the correct solution. We have earlier seen that greedy method has only the problem that because it takes the locally optimal choices in the hope to get the global maximum solution, and therefore it is not guaranteed that you would be able to get the global solution. So sometime you may not be getting the global optimal solution. So the global optimal solution is guaranteed to be found if you can if your problem is of such nature that you can map it to the matroids. Make sense? So let us, in this particular session, we are going to talk about that what are the properties of matroids and how you can define it and some of the things. So let us start our discussion. So matroids, we are going to talk about the matroids. They are some... it gives a theory for some situations in which the greedy algorithm yields optimal solution. So we are going to use the greedy algorithm. Why we are going to use the greedy solutions? Because in most of the cases, it's a combinatorics problem, type of problem. Combinatorial problem where lot of things are there and you want to find out a particular combination that actually suits you. So you know that these kind of problem are actually exponential, so finding out the right solution becomes very difficult if you go ahead and explore all the possibilities. So greedy says that you go into the sequential manner. Greedy says that you go into sequential manner. So matroids are here that are going to give us a kind of mathematical theory that we can utilize to tell that actually some important greedy property exists in our problem, and therefore we can solve this problem in an efficient way, and we would be getting the right optimal solution. So matroid is defined in this way that matroid actually has two items, S and I. What? S and I. The matroid has two sets. One set is S and another set is I. S is a finite set, so you can have some item over there, but the set is finite. Please try to note. S is a finite set. What about I? I is another set. Actually, items of the S are actually given to you, but items of the I are not given to you. For them, some property is defined. Two properties are defined. The first property is the hereditary property. The first property is the hereditary property. That says that very simple thing, that into the I, let's assume there is something there into I. So for example, some B is there. And you know there is another set A that is a subset of B. So the hereditary property says that A also belongs to I. Okay? Means if you have a set, so all the subsets of the B are also there into I. Make sense? Hereditary property clear? Is it clear to you? Yes or no? Okay. So there is a question that whether phi is a member of I or not. Can you tell me? Okay. Ignaz is asking that, sir, can you please repeat? We'll repeat here once again. Okay. So I'm telling that matroid is actually a set that has two items, S and I. Clear, Ignaz? Yes. What they are, we would talk later. I'm just talking about some properties. S in itself is a set that is finite. I is also a set that have two properties. I is also a set that has two properties, and we are going to talk about that. First property is called hereditary property. Okay. And one more thing that, let me first tell that what is the hereditary property. So hereditary property is this, that in this set I, if there is some B which belongs to this particular set, and there is some smaller set, for example, A, which is a subset of B, then it implies that A also belongs to I. So this is what the hereditary property is. Igna, is it fine? Whether this part is clear? B subset of I. No, B belongs to I. Okay. B belongs to I. B is some set. And A and B are actually, A and B both are actually subsets of S. They are subsets of S. Okay. So I am telling that if in this particular set, if there is something that belongs to this particular set I, and there is some subset of B, that is A, then A also belongs to I. This is what I wanted to tell you. Okay. So my question is, I have just asked that, can you tell me that what is whether phi is a member of I or not? That if anything is there, for example, any ABCD is there inside A, so you know that phi is a subset of A. So definitely phi is going to be a member of this particular set I. Okay. All right. Also, there is a small definition. I is a non-empty, means I have also some of the items. I is also non-empty set. And you have seen that at least phi is always there. Is non-empty family of subsets of S. Subsets of S means if you take S and find out who are the subsets. So for if any given set, how many subsets are possible? 2 to the power n. Okay. But I'm not taking all of them. Some of them I would be taking. So out of these 2 to the power n possibilities, few of them I am going to choose and I am going to put into I. So at this point, it should be clear when you read this highlighted line, I is a non-empty family of subset of S. This part is clear? Any questions on that? I is non-empty family of subset of S. Call independent subset. We would be calling it independent subset of S. So it is independent just for the historical reasons. I'm going to call it independent, but means still, I think this is the important part. That as I told you, that inside I, subset of S is there. Subset of S is there inside the I. Make sense? Two things are clear. Once again, let me tell you that what is matroid? Matroid is a set called S and I, two items, is a tuple that contains S and I. Matroid is a tuple that contains S and I, where S is a set that is finite, means finite element number of items are there. I is a another set that contains subsets of S, not all subsets of S, some of the subsets of S having some properties. These subsets, whatever items are there, based on that, I has a property. What is the property? The first property is this hereditary property. And we have talked about what is the hereditary property, that if you pick any item from this particular I, then all the subsets who are the subsets of B, they are also going to be inside this I. Okay. The second property is an important property, and it is called the exchange property. Two property are there. Okay. Second property is the exchange property. There are two property related to the I. Second property is the exchange property. This property says that inside I, if you see that two items are there, A and B. Okay. So it may be possible that size of one is actually greater. For example, if size of A is lesser than the size of B. So who have the more item? Sir, please give an example of Metroid with S is equal to 1, 2, 3. Okay. So example of Metroid would differently come. Try to understand these properties. Okay. Right now, if I'm going to give the example, so without more things, it may become wrong. So finite set, let's assume S have something, for example, A, B, and C. Okay. S is equal to, let's assume that S is equal to A, B, and C. What is I? I don't know. So I contain phi and some of the subsets of A, for example, A and B, C. Let's assume that A, it contains A and B, C. So because of this hereditary property, if BC is there, so B would also be there because B is a subset of BC. C would also be there because C is a subset of this. So I would contain all these items. Make sense? Areman, now is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Areman?
Yes, sir, I understood.
Please don't speak, I'm not listening, okay? You may type. Ariman, yeah? Okay. So let us talk about this second property for the I, that is exchange property. It says that if you pick any two sets from this, any two sets A and B you pick, such that size of A is lesser than the size of B. So can you give me an example? For example, I say that set A that contains this and B can be B and C. This set. What is the size of BC? It is 2. What is the size of A? Is equal to 1. So this property is satisfied. Okay. So exchange property says that there exist some element X inside B minus A. So can you give me what is B minus A? B minus A means BC minus A. BC minus A is BC itself. Okay. So there is some item in BC minus A, that is BC in our case, such that what? A union X also belongs to I. Okay. So this is an important property that says that can you give me any X from this particular set? So who could be X? X could be either B or X could be either C. It says that if you can combine A with the X, it would also belong to that. What do I mean by this? I mean by this that A can be combined X. X can be added to A. So what are the possibility of X? Possibility of X is B and C. When you combine A union X, what is A union X? A union X is equal to, can you tell me? AB. A union X is equal to AC. So it is telling that these two things also need to be brought into the set. So this I would also have A, B and A, C. Make sense? Ariman? Second property is a bit tricky. That says that there exists exchange property. What is the meaning of exchange property? Means if you find out anything, any set, the one set, you find out two sets such that one is bigger than another. You find out two sets such as one is bigger than another, this property. If you find out two sets inside the I, okay, if A and B belongs to I, you find out two sets such that one is larger than this, then inside B you can find out any X. There exists a X such that if you add this to the X, that particular thing would also belong to I. So Rahul is telling, it says that there exists. So both AC and AB need not to be there. So very excellent point, Rahul. Rahul is telling that since this definition says, and actually I wanted to point out this, so Rahul has pointed into the right manner, said there exists some element X into the B minus A. So just now what I said you, that possibility for X where B and C, and if I take the B, the set becomes AB. If I take the C, set becomes AC. But actually, as it is saying that both need not to be there. At least one of them need to be there. At least one of them. Both can also be there. So Rahul, if both are there, there is no problem. Okay. However, if both are not there, then it is also fine. Okay. Based on the definition as it is written. So if at least one is going to be there, this is an important property. Okay. So matroid is actually this kind of combinatorial structure that have this kind of property. Any questions on that? So till now it is very, very simple and clear, and hope it is fine to you. So matroid is this. Make sense? That I have a matroid is a tuple having S and I. S is a finite set, so there is no problem in that definition. However, for the S, we have the definition. One is the two property need to be there. Hereditary property means if you find out any set, then there must be all the subsets should also be there. Exchange property says that if you find something larger of the larger size, then at least one item from there you can take and put it, you can combine it with yourself and you can make this particular set bigger. Okay. So now I want to talk about an example, and this example is called the graphic matroid. This example is called the graphic matroid. I'm going to talk about the example of a matroid. So focus on this. So graphic matroid is actually defined with respect to a graph. So let me consider a graph. There are graph means how, what? Few nodes. A, B, C, D, E, F. Graph has some edges. So this is a edge, this is a edge, let's assume this is an edge, this is an edge, this is an edge, this is an edge. Let's assume that this is an edge. This also, let me call it edge. So let's assume that this is what I have. This is what I graph I have. Okay. So I write edge name. It is AB. It is BC. It is CD. It is BD. It is BF. It is AE. It is DE. And it is CE. It is FD. So these are the edges I have. So help me to write out this. So here graph is defined. Everybody knows that if you want to define a graph, you have to define two things, V and E. What is V? V is the set of vertices. So I would be defining vertices as A, B, C, D, E, and F. I have to define edges, and edges I can define as AB. Please help me. BC, BF, BD, CD, CE, DE, FD, AE. So if I forget anything, please let me know. So these many edges are there. Okay. So this is what the initial setting is. I have a graph, and I just told you what is a graph. Everybody is okay with this graph? Yes. So you are okay with the graph? Now let me tell you what is a matroid. Let me build a matroid, graphic matroid. That matroid would be called graphic matroid because I am defining the matroid on the graph. Graphic matroid is defined in this way, that for any matroid, I have to define two things. What are they? S and I, these two things I have to define. Okay. So S is equal to E. All the edges are into S. So what is S? So here I can write that it is S. Make sense? Is it clear? This part is clear. What is S? Edges. How I am going to define the I? So I is defined in this way. If A is a subset of E, then A is inside the I if and only if A is acyclic. If and only if A is acyclic. What do I mean by this? I mean by this that I take a subset of S, subset of E. First thing, please concentrate. What is this? Let us concentrate. A is a subset of E. What is E as is? So can you give me any subset of A? So let me write A is equal to subset of edges. Subset of edges. So let me just use this thing. Say, let me select few edges. Okay. This edge I have selected. This edge I have selected. Let's assume this edge I am selecting. And I am selecting this edge. Okay. I am selecting this. So A has BC, BD, CD, and FD. Any problem in this? I have selected this set. Still now I have talked about A is a subset of E. This part is clear. A is a subset of E. Everybody, is it clear? Yeah. But the second part is this, that A is acyclic. It should be acyclic. There should not be any cycle. Okay. It is inside IG if and only if A is acyclic. So what I want that A should be acyclic. So to make it acyclic, I have to drop something because it is cyclic. There is a cycle. You can see, no? There is a cycle. This is a cycle. So there is a problem. Either I have to remove BC or CD or this, at least one I have to remove so that the cycle goes away. So let me say that I'm removing BD. I'm removing this. Okay, so let me remove it. This set is inside I. Is it clear? So inside I, this is there. This set is there. This set that contains B, C, C, D, and F, D. Inside I, it is there. Whether this part is clear to everybody? Yes. So if I ask you that in this particular I, if AC is there, type yes or no. AC is there. Yes, because AC is not forming any cycle. Is there AC, DE, FD, and BF is there, yes, because till now there is a AC, DE, FD, and BF. Till now there is no cycle. Can I add here BD? No. Can I add here AB? No. AC is not an S. Okay, sorry. Thank you very much. AE. Fine. Thank you. Is it fine now? Shubham? Okay, na? Yes. So I'm happy that you are catching all these things. So hope it is clear to you. Okay. Please, now at this particular moment, I want to tell you. So let me clear this. I have told you a lot of things. So let me tell you another thing that is very important, that in this kind of setting, when I'm going to define the matroid, there I have to tell two things. What are those things? What are those two things? Those things are capital S and I. I would provide you the S because it is a finite set. I can provide you. But I would not provide. I would provide the definition of this particular thing. And using that definition, you can verify that if an item is given, if an item set is given, whether it belongs to I or not, you can tell me. Set, because this set is going to be very large. All the items which belongs into the I would not be provided to you. Only definition is provided, so you can construct, you can think that these items are there or not there, but these set is not provided to you. However, this S is completely provided to you because you have to find out the subset. This part is clear? Any issues? No issues. Okay. Very good. Okay. Then we have to show that we have to prove that it is a matroid. This is a matroid. We have to prove it. This, whatever definition we have given to you, can we prove it that it is a matroid? So we have just given a definition where I told you that how to create this S and how to create an I. But whether it is a matroid, we have to provide the proof. So how can I prove it? You have to show me these properties, that S is finite. First, you tell that S is finite, this first property. So whether this first property is right, because S is equal to S. So in any undirected graph, if the graph is given to me, it is a finite graph that have finite number of vertices, then it has a finite number of edges. So therefore, S is of finite size. Everybody is okay with me that this particular property is satisfied? Yes? Yes? Let us try to understand that what is hereditary property? It says that if I find out some B inside the I, so focus on this B. What is this B? B is set of edges that does not have a cycle. Okay? That does not have a cycle. B is a subset of I. That does not have a cycle. If I find something A that is subset of B, how can I find out this? How can I find out a subset of this? No issue, delete. Something from B, some edges from B. So if you find out an A by deleting something, Does it have a cycle? Does it have a cycle? No, because into the B there was no cycle, removing something is not going to introduce any cycle. So think about in a fresh manner that now you have a set that does not have a cycle. So will this set would be inside I or not? Will this be inside I or not? It would be inside the I. So therefore, any subset of B also belongs to I. So this property, hereditary property, is satisfied. Make sense? Yes? Make sense? So hereditary property says that the subset of a forest is forest. So one more property is remaining, that is called this exchange property. But before talking to that, because there is a new word, let me talk about this word. What is the forest? What does the forest means? Okay. Why I have written that forest term? So you assume that this is your graph. Let's assume that you have a graph. In graph, there are vertices. In graph, there are vertices. Okay. So there are edges also. Okay. Let's assume that there are edges. There are some edges. There are some edges. And there are some edges. And I am selecting a set. I am selecting a set B in such a way there is no cycle. Okay. So what I wanted to tell you is this, that I can pick the things in this way. For example, here you consider only these dots. Okay. And these dots are a trees. These dots are tree. Assume them as a tree. Okay. If I connect two things, so how many trees we have? Let's assume that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 trees were there. Now if I connect any two things, how many trees we have? 6. If I connect anything else, how many trees we have? 5. If I connect this, how many trees I have? 4. If I connect something more, okay, actually, if I connect this, how many now trees are there? 3 trees. Okay, which are these 3 trees? Tree number 1, tree number 2, and tree number 3. These 3 trees we have. If I connect this thing, now how many trees we have? Same, it remains 3. But can I take it inside the B? Can I take this is inside this B? This new is. I'm just talking about this new is. Okay. I'm talking about this new is. Can I take this new is into the B? Answer is no. Because it will make cycle. Okay. So I cannot take it. So whatever I have selected, let me show you that what I have selected. Right now I'm on the right track. I have selected the right thing. So what are the things I have? So do you think what it is? What do you think what it is? It is a forest. What is this? It is a forest. Because there would be trees and more than one trees. If there are more than one trees, it is called forest. So whatever things are there into I, they are all forest. You may think this, I think this is needed at this particular moment to tell you that from very high level perspective, just you see that these are the nodes. And inside B, there are few connections. These connections could be anything. And whenever you are going to make a connection, whatever number of connection you are going to make, you are going to make a set B. That set belongs to this particular I. So things which are there inside the I, they are actually forest. Any problem in that? In this concept? That till now, I have not told it, but it was the right time to tell you that whatever things are there inside the B, they are actually inside the I, they are actually the forest. So everybody can visualize it, that what is I? I is the collection of forest. I is a collection of forest. Is a set containing last lot of forest. Make sense? So we are talking about the third property. That is a very interesting property. That says, what it says? That that if there is any B inside I, and you find any A that is a subset of B. Is it like that? No. Exchange property is different. One minute. Let me tell you. Exchange property says that if A and B are there inside I, and size of A is actually less than size of B, then there exists an X that can be added to A. Okay. What do I mean by this? So what I wanted to tell that in this setting, let's assume these are the node. So B is this. Let's assume the B is this. This, this, and this. Let's assume this is B. Okay. So how many edges are there? Three edges are there. Let me say that there is an A. A has also, let me also make A. By example, it is easy to show. So A could be anything. Okay. But it cannot be 3. Let's assume take 2 only. Okay. This is B and A. So the property says that there exists a X. And what is X? X is an is, okay? So that you can put that X into A, and it is also a forest. Make sense? So what is that? Can you help me find out something into B that I can put it here? Okay. So let me tell you one thing, that the proof is actually, there are multiple ways to prove it. One proof that actually what I like is this, that that you actually start from the blank mind. It says that you start from the blank mind. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Let's assume that these are the six points. And one by one, if you introduce A is, that is there into B. So what happens that before introduction of this thing, I have just few minutes back written the same thing. How many trees are there into this set? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six things. But when you introduce a particular is, number of trees becomes 5. When you introduce another thing, the number of trees become 4. When you put another thing, number of trees becomes 3. So it has now 3 trees. Okay. Point is this. My question is this. Can I put this thing? can I put this particular is into A? Can I put a as that was B inside the B inside the A? Can anybody tell? Yes, we can put it. Okay, this by this example it looks like that I can put this one here. Can I put this one here? Yes. Can I put this one here? Yes. So looks like that all the three can be placed, but however this is not going to be candidate because it was already there. It may be possible that So how to find out one? Question is that how to find out one that is a candidate for the X? How to find out the one that is a candidate for X? Okay. So what I wanted to tell you is this, that one by one pick each of them and put it here and try to see whether they are connecting two trees or not. This particular is which lies inside B, when it is put inside A, it connects two trees. This part is clear to everyone? Not clear? Please ask. Not clear, then please write, say no. Okay. Let me tell you. From the B, I have picked this particular is and placed it here. I can see that this one and this one was a two separate trees. So this is actually going to connect two trees. Whether it is fine to everybody? Nobody writing yes. Igna? Yeah. So my point is that if I pick this one and put it here, I am connecting two trees. Okay. If I put this one over here, is it connecting two trees? If I put this one here, it is connecting two trees? No. So you got yes and then you got no. If I pick the third one and put it here, is it connecting two trees? Yes. Okay. Everybody is okay with this? So I am going to again delete this thing and tell you one thing, that for each of the edges that are there into B, for example this one, for example this one, for example this one, I am going to find out whether yes or no is there or no, not. Okay, what is yes or no? That if I put it inside the A, whether it is going to connect two trees. Okay. This part is clear. Now I wanted to ask a question, that can all these values be no? This is a very important question. And this is a heart of our lecture. Can I tell that all the values are no? Yes? Yes. Risho? Risho, everybody, please, whoever is present, please write that. What do you think? That can I get all no's? No. Since B is larger than A, no. No. Anybody telling yes? So let me tell you, this is the most important part of this lecture. The answer is no. Why? Because this is not going to add two trees. This any A's that I'm going to pick from B is not going to add into this in not going to connect two trees. Any A's from B is not going to connect two trees if it is inside a already existing tree. Okay, if you are going to connect into the already existing tree. So inside a already existing tree, if you can put it, for example, here, if there is an ex tree existing, so if somebody connect here, then only he would not be able to connect something, na? So if there is a tree inside A, how many nodes are, how many things are there, how many edges are there, and minus one, if consider that it contains a subset of n things, so n minus one nodes will be there. At most, those many things I can if let's assume that same thing is also here, or there is a same things are connected over here. So in this portion, maybe something is connected like this, something connected like this. If I take that thing and put it here, then only I would not be able to connect. So at most, n minus one item from here, they can come here and they can tell that they can be placed over here. So you can think in that this way also, that everything if what you are going to put, if they are either you can put it here, either you can put into the already existing tree. So you can think in this way, that all the edges, whatever edges you are going to consider from the B, either you put it into the already existing tree. If you are not putting into the already existing tree, then they are going to count. I think this is a clear thing to tell. Whatever you have, if you are putting into the already existing tree into the A, then only they are not going to connect two trees. Make sense? Okay, so if you are going to take it and put it into the already existing tree, take it and put into the already existing tree, put it into the already existing tree. So how many trees are there? There are n less than n. If B contains n number of items, then there are at least at most n minus one number of places are here, which you can avoid. Okay, which you can avoid. You keep it here. Put it here, so at least at most n minus one you can avoid that. If by chance they are going to match and you are going to put into the same tree, then they are not going to connect. So at least there would be one yes. It means there could be multiple s here, but at least there could be one yes. One s means two different thing you are going to connect. So you take that thing, you put it into this particular place. Whether the proof is clear to everybody? Whether the proof is clear, what I wanted to tell. So this is an important proof that tells that definitely you would find out a particular is that you can put into the A. Makes sense? Definitely you can find out some x that you can put it here. So this is we wanted. This we wanted that if the size of A is lesser than the size of B, then inside B we would definitely find an S that I can put it into inside the A. Why I can put it inside the A? Because putting this when I'm connecting two trees, then it is not going to form any cycle. Putting the things, putting an S that are connecting two trees, it is not going to form cycle. So I can put inside the A, and it would make another set that is A dash, and A dash would be inside I. This part is clear? Yes, whether this part is clear? So this is the third property, that if size of A is less than size of B, then B has fewer number of trees. And consider then A is X that links two trees into inside the A. So X, I can use that particular link to put inside the A, make some A dash, and this would also be inside the A because there would not be any cycle. We say that this particular A extends A. Okay. Okay. So this part is clear, that it can be extended. So inside I, this, all these three properties are satisfied. Since all these three properties are satisfied, this third property is also being satisfied. So the whatever we have defined, whatever graphic matroid, in the whatever way that we have defined the graphic matroid, is going to be a matroid. All the properties are there. So we have seen that important property, that X extends A. We can find out AX that extends A. Then if it can extend, then it can again extend, keep extending until the size become maximal. So there is a concept of the maximal independent set, that the set that now cannot be extended, whose size is actually maximum and it cannot be extended. This is what the maximal independent set, the size of that particular set, for example, A. Now, if the A becomes A dash, and then after that, it reaches to a maximum size, that is, that particular set is called the maximal independent set. Make sense? So that's all for today. We would continue tomorrow. As you know, that we have an extra class tomorrow, 11 to 12. So we would be meeting once again and going ahead with this definitions. So thank you very much. Any questions till now? Any questions? Thank you.